It is day 2 of Mental Health Awareness Month, and in this video, we're gonna be talking about how one psychopath pretty much got away with murder. So, we're gonna discuss that story, we're gonna discuss that case, but this is a broader topic that I really wanna talk about with all of you and get all of your opinions on. What is up, everybody? This is Chris from The Rewired Soul, where we talk about the problem, but focus on the solution. And if you're new to my channel, I try to take different topics from the YouTube community or the news or pop culture and try to see what we can learn from them. And something I'm very, very, very passionate about is mental health. So if you're into that stuff, make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell. So I just put up a poll over on my Twitter. By the way, if you're not following me on Twitter, go follow me at The Rewired Soul, same over on Instagram. And I asked, I was like, yo, I'm reading this very interesting book on psychopaths and it's given me a million video ideas. Do you want me to do like a series on psychopaths? And I'm gonna leave the poll up, but so far a lot of people do, right? But anyways, the book I'm reading is called The Wisdom of Psychopaths. I'm gonna link it down in the description below if you wanna check that book out. Like, it's really, really, really fascinating. I know a lot of people out there like myself are just kind of curious and fascinated by psychopaths, serial killers, cults, everything like that. Sarah Hawkinson actually just did a really good video about serial killer tattoos and like kind of why we're interested in these types of things, but this book actually explains a little bit more in depth why we're interested in these things, right? Like, it's not for a lot of us, but not all of us, for a lot of us, it's not to glorify these people, but we're just kind of intrigued and we want to study and kind of understand what's going on. But anyways, check out The Wisdom of Psychopaths if you're into that stuff. But yeah, I just came across a story in there about a case of a guy named Bradley Waldrop, okay? So this is a story from, I believe, 2006, okay? So Bradley Waldrop, he is a man who lived in Tennessee, and his wife, I believe, was dropping off the kids, and she came with her friend, and the guy had been drinking. Him and the wife got into an argument or something like that, and he ended up shooting the wife's friends, the friend, 8 times, and then cutting her head open with some object. Then he went after his ex-wife with a machete, all right? She ended up losing a finger, he hacked her up, but she did survive, thankfully, all right? So he got arrested and there was a big case around this, and this is kind of a groundbreaking case because they're using like neuroscience, which got this guy's sentence reduced from first degree murder and attempted murder to voluntary manslaughter. So in the state of Tennessee, there is the death penalty. So basically, the guy's still doing a life sentence in prison, but he's not facing the death penalty, okay? So here's what the defense's argument was. So they ended up bringing up what's called, well, what the media has named the warrior gene, okay? So I'm gonna be reading from an NPR article that I'm gonna link down in the description below, but here's what it says. They've tested some 30 criminal defendants, most of whom were charged with murder. They were looking for a particular variant of the MAOA gene, also known as the warrior gene because it has been associated with violence. Burnett says they found that Waldrop has the high-risk version of the gene. Quote, his genetic makeup combined with his history of child abuse together created a vulnerability that he would be a violent adult, Burnett explains. Over the fierce opposition of prosecutors, the judge allowed Burnett to testify in court that these two factors help explain why Waldrop snapped that murderous night. So anyways, the MAOA gene is associated with violence, but anyways, I'm gonna link a few resources down below, but basically it creates an enzyme that links up with neurotransmitters, to my understanding, that create things like serotonin, dopamine, endorphins, everything like that. Pretty much the happy chemicals, okay? So this also gets into a discussion about epigenetics. So those of you who don't know what epigenetics are basically genes that lie dormant within you until something triggers them and activates them, right? Typically for most people, it's some kind of traumatic experience. So I come from an addiction treatment center, background, and I've done a lot of studying about this. Although I'm not like a licensed therapist or anything like that, it's something that I had to learn about working at an addiction treatment center, doing groups for clients and everything. So anyways, this is often seen in drug and alcohol addiction, is that there is a gene linked up with an addiction, right? But this gene might not be activated until something traumatic. So this is one of the reasons why war veterans, you know, they never had an issue with substance abuse, but they come back and then they develop a substance problem, right? Because during that traumatic experience, gene activated. This is also very common with people who have been, you know, in abusive relationships and things like that. So anyways, when it comes to the MAOA gene, they're talking about epigenetics as well. They're talking about how this gene can actually lie dormant in people unless something traumatic happens. So they said that this is a dangerous cocktail because in Bradley Waldrop's case, he was not only somebody with this gene that is associated with violence, but he was also abused repeatedly, physically abused as a child. So he was at a very high risk of becoming a violent criminal later on in his life, because they've done other studies that they talked about in this book, The Wisdom of Psychopaths, where they actually studied and followed a bunch of kids and into adulthood where they had this gene and they were at a higher risk of developing psychopathic tendencies, okay? So this is something to take into account. So basically the defense's argument is, when you take these two things, when you take the guy's genetics and his history of abuse, is he really responsible for his crime, right? How responsible is he? This is where free will comes into play. And this is, free will is a topic that I am absolutely fascinated with. I'll link another book down in the description below. Sam Harris wrote a very short book. The audiobook is only like an hour, I think, but it's called Free Will. I've talked about it in older videos on my channel, but we think we're in control. We think we are, but there's so many other factors at play inside of our mind and everything like that. So, but this, the problem is that this is very scary, right? This is scary. This is the issue that prosecutors had. This is the issue that other psychologists had reviewing this case, is that it sets a dangerous precedent, right? Because if we start blaming somebody's genetics and their childhood history on the violent crimes they're committing today, is anybody really going to be held accountable for their crimes? Something that I talked about, I think in a Gypsy Rose Blanchard video, was that most people in prison had some kind of terrible upbringing. You know what I mean? And my argument is that, you know, prison should be more of a rehabilitation rather than just like, you know, just pure imprisonment, pure punishment. In some cases with like the for-profit prisons, it's almost like slavery, you know what I mean? But in some cases like Bradley Waldrop, is that a little too far? So here's the question I wanna pose to you, because this has been on my mind after I heard about this. My girlfriend and I were having a discussion about this. So there are genes that we know are linked with, you know, violence, aggression, psychopathy, with addiction, you know, all these other things. Like for me, addiction runs in my family. My grandmother actually had a test done and we found that the addiction gene is on her side of the family. And I am an addict in recovery. My mom's an addict in recovery. Her sister, my uncle, and some other people in my family are addicts in recovery. So as a father, I look at that with my son. I'm like, oh, this kid is screwed, right? So here's the question. If we know genetics can play a role in not just psychopathy, but in other things like PTSD, they've done studies where grandchildren of Holocaust survivors are more prone to PTSD with the way the genetics are passed down. If we know who's going to be more susceptible to addiction, to depression, to anxiety, to all these things, my question is, why aren't we testing kids at a younger age? Like, why isn't this part of it? Like, there are tests that can be done. Like, if you are pregnant, you can have tests done to see if your child is prone to any kind of like physical illnesses, right? But like, obviously there are genetic tests so we could see if there are mental illnesses. So here's the thing, like at what point are we responsible as parents, as adults, the medical community, to start testing kids for these things? Because in my opinion, this gives us a way to kind of start looking for the signs at a younger age and intervene even earlier. You see what I mean? Like, if we were testing kids, like if I, you know, as a parent who knows that addiction runs in my family, I have my eye on my son. It's not something I like, you know, hound him about. I'm like, oh, you're acting like a little addict playing Fortnite or anything like that. But I keep an eye on him and I keep an eye on his behaviors because he's 10 years old. Next thing you know, he's a teenager and everything like that. So while I'm not having like regular panic attacks about this, it's something that I can keep an eye out for. So the only thing that I can really think of is the money involved, right? Like, so here in the United States, at least, the medical system isn't all that great. Even if you have really great health insurance, things cost money. Because, for example, like, fMRI brain scans tell us a lot about mental illness, tell us a lot about the brain and everything. But, like, insurance just doesn't pay for that. So, the question is like, how do we get funding for this? How do we make this something that becomes more, like, not even more standard, but just standard to test children to see if they're prone to anything that might turn them into a problematic adult. You know what I mean? But for right now, until that day comes, and this is just Chris imagining a beautiful world, until that day comes, I think more and more of these cases, more and more of these issues with mental illness and things like that, like I've talked about how people who were abused as children are more likely to develop symptoms of like borderline personality disorder. So until this genetic testing starts happening on a regular basis, we as adults, we as parents have even more of a responsibility to be good parents, all right? And if you have somebody in your life, maybe it's a niece, a nephew, somebody, a child in your life, a teenager, whoever it is, like keep an eye out, be a role model, be a mentor for that person, because early intervention is the key, in my opinion, if we want to stop really, really bad mental health issues in the future. All right, but let me know your thoughts on this topic down in the comments below, okay? And again, go follow me on Instagram and over on Twitter at The Rewired Soul. I'm going to be putting up a bunch of polls because I'm here to make content for you, baby. That's what I do, all right? So make sure you're following me. But if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. If you're new, make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell because I make a ton of videos. And a huge, huge thank you to everybody supporting the channel over on Patreon. You're all amazing. And if you would like to become a patron, get involved in our monthly Q&A, help support me what I'm doing here, get some other perks and benefits, you can click or tap right there. All right, thanks again so much for watching. I'll see you next time.